38, Paul challenged the believers in Corinth to always be abounding in the word of the Lord. My brothers and my sisters, you are not saved to sleep through your Christian life. You are saved to serve with your Christian life. And you have a place to serve because you have a duty to serve. Right now, there's something for you to do in the kingdom of God. You have a role, you have a labor, you have a work to do. There's a place for your service. But then not only is there a place for your service, but notice secondly, from the parable, there is a promise with your service. In chapter 19, Peter asked a question that if we're honest, most of us have asked at one time or another in our life. In verse 27, Peter asked, what shall we have, therefore? Peter essentially was saying, Lord, what are we going to get for serving you? In other words, Peter's saying, what's in it for us? And it sounds like an irreverent question, and to some degree it is. But yet our Lord tells Peter, those who give themselves in the service of the Lord can rest assured that God will take care of them.
All right.
And as you look at how God responded to Peter, chapter 19, there are a couple of truths that we find about the promise that comes with our service. Notice, first of all, the promise of reward is clear.
All right.
Peter blurts out this selfish and yet all too human question in verse 27. Peter said, what's in it for me? While most of us may not say those very words, there's a part of us that wants to know that we're going to get something for our effort. Am I right? You would almost expect Jesus to rebuke Peter, but instead he tells Peter, along with the other disciples, they're going to be rewarded with the privilege of reigning with him when he sets up his kingdom on the earth. He goes on to verse 29 and said, and everyone that has forsaken houses, or brethren, or sisters, or father, or mother, or wife, or children, or lands, for my sake, shall receive an hundredfold, and shall inherit everlasting life. Jesus makes it clear that those who suffer in this life to serve him will be handsomely rewarded. Time spent in service to Christ is time that will reap eternal and extraordinary reward. I read once about a preacher that died, went to heaven. When he arrived at the celestial city, he realized that a New York taxi driver had been given a bigger mansion than him. He complained to St. Peter, but to no avail. Peter explained to him that in heaven, rewards are given based on results. He went on and said, when you preach, some listened and some slept. When this man drove his taxi, the people riding with him not only stayed awake, but they prayed. And so who will get the most rewards in heaven is something we do not yet know, which is part of the reason Jesus gave the parable in chapter 20. What we do know is that the promise of rewards is clear. Those that labor for Christ will be rewarded. Can I get it with you? There's something else we must see about this promise that comes with our service. Notice not only that the promise of reward is clear, but notice also that the promise of reward is conditional. While your salvation is by grace through faith, and there's nothing you can do to earn it, that's not the case when it comes to rewards. The rewards given in heaven are based upon your work. And let me say this, I mean no harm here tonight. Those who work will be rewarded. But those who do not work should not expect to receive anything. Did y'all hear what I said?
I hear you.
I said those who work will be rewarded. But those who do not work should not expect to receive anything. and they join the church.
Yeah.
And that's all. Uh-huh. Sometimes they come in and they go out and you never see them no more. They're not part of the body. They don't work. They don't do. They come in, they join, and that's all.
Mm-hmm. Well,
and they disappear for 30 and 40 years.
Well,
we got. What I'm trying to say is, we'll be judged and rewarded based upon what we have done. While the owner in the parable was generous with his money, he was not giving away his money.
Right.
Only those laborers that entered into the vineyard to work were rewarded at the end of the day.
Okay.
I mean no harm today, but don't be foolish. If you do nothing for Christ down here, don't expect him to come in and reward you up there.
Yeah. Well,
the rewards of heaven are conditional.
Uh-huh.
Based upon our laborers in this world.
Uh-huh.
It said that in 1877, Charles Luther heard a preacher tell the story of a young man who had just recently accepted Christ, but was very rapidly nearing his death.
Uh-huh.
His pastor was trying to encourage him when the young man said, I'm not afraid to die. Jesus saved me now, but must I go empty-handed? And from that story, Luther wrote these lines. Must I go and empty-handed, thus my dear Redeemer meet? Not one day of service give him, lay no trophy at his feet.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, my brothers and my sisters, one day you and I are going to stand in the awesome and overwhelming presence of the living Christ. And if we have done nothing for him down here, we will have nothing to give him up there.
Yeah.
I want to say to somebody tonight, don't go empty-handed. Don't meet with regret the Christ that redeemed you. Serve him now so that you may have something to give him then.
Yeah.
Can I get a witness?
Yes, sir.
This parable tonight reminds us that there's a place for your service. And there's a promise with your service.
Yeah.
Both of these are important truths, but neither of them are the real reason this parable was given.
Uh-huh.
Notice with me a third and most important truth we find in this parable.
Uh-huh.
As you come to the close of the story, we see thirdly, there is a peril in your service.
All right.
That word peril could also, another word for peril is danger.
Yes,
sir. There is a peril or a danger in your service.
Yeah.
Now, when you read the Lord's response to Peter's question at the close of chapter 19, you almost wondered if Jesus was ignoring Peter's mercenary what's in it for the end.
Well.
Then when you read the parable of the laborers in the vineyard, you understand that Jesus uses this parable to warn Peter about the attitude that prompted his question.
Well, now.
In the character of the first laborers hired and their frustrations at the end of the day, we learn about some perils or some dangers that we must watch for in serving Christ.
All right.
And here's where this quaint parable suddenly becomes a sharp and biting story.
Well, now.
Notice with me these perils or dangers we must watch for when we serve Jesus Christ.
All right.
There is first peril or the danger of negotiating the favor of God.
Uh-huh.
Now look back at chapter 20 and notice the close of the parable. When the owner paid the employees for the day and the first worker saw that they had been paid equal to the last workers in verse 11. Verse 11 says that they murmured. They began to about the fact that while they had worked all day, those who had labored only 1 hour received the same wage as them. But then notice verse 13. The owner answered them and says, friend, I do thee no wrong. Didst not thou agree with me for a penny? The owner was right. At the beginning of the day, in verse 2, first laborers negotiated their price and agreed to a penny.
Well,
the other laborers went into the vineyard based on the agreement found in verse 4.
Yeah.
The owner said to them, whatsoever is right, I mind will give him.
Yes,
there are those, my brothers and my sisters, who will serve God, but they want to negotiate their price up front. They say, Lord, I will serve you, but you better bless me financially. Or others will say, I will serve you and I will work in the church, but I better get some kind of recognition. I will not work without getting some kind of credit. Do you see the subtle danger in that?
Yeah.
I want to say to all of us who are here, don't negotiate with God for his favor.
No, no.
Just agree to serve him and let God take care of taking care of you. Because nobody knows how to take care of you better than Jesus did.
Yes.
Yes,
sir. Yes, sir.
Then there's another parable of danger that we find addressed in this story. Mm. We find not only the parable of danger of negotiating the favor of God, but you also find the parable of danger of debating the fairness of God. Look at verse 12 in this parable. The first word we are crumbling, and they say, these lands have wrought but 1 hour. Thou hast made them equal unto us, which have borne the burden and heat of the day. First workers did not think what the owner was doing was fair.
Well,
it did not matter to them that he was the owner. It did not matter to them that he could do whatever he wanted to do.
Well,
it did not matter to them that he was taking care of them just as he had promised. They still debated the fairness of their master.
Yeah.
I mean no harm tonight. There are those of us who are constantly looking around at what God is doing in the lives of other people. And if God blesses someone around us or around them, they are hurt and bothered by what they perceive to be an injustice.
All right.
They say, I've done more than them. I've given more than them. Why does God can I get a witness?
Yeah.
Notice that carefully, the owner responds in verse 15.
Yeah.
Verse 15, he says, is it not lawful for me to do what I will with my own?
No.
Is I not evil?
Yeah.
Because I am good?
Well,
the rebuke is clear. Jesus uses this parable to remind us of an age-old truth. We got to mind our own business.
Yeah.
Can I get a witness?
Yes, sir.
If God chooses to bless my neighbor, that's between God and my neighbor. It in no way means that he's not fair to me. Isn't that right? If we're not careful, like Peter, we'll begin to ask, Lord, what's in it for me?
Yeah.
And the simple answer is that there's more in it for us than we could ever even imagine. Yet at the same time, we began to negotiate the favor of God and debate the fairness of God, we missed the whole point of laboring for the Lord.
Right.
And in many ways, we run the risk of being last in terms of rewards, even though we were first in terms of service. And so then, this is a parable then that deals with some very relevant and important issues. The Church of Jesus Christ needs more of its professing members to become participating members. Let me say that again. The Church of Jesus Christ, amen, needs more of its professing members to become participating members. There is work to be done, am I right? And it is astoundingly rewarding work. And both of these truths are presented in this story. In the heart of the story deals with an even greater issue, and that issue is our motive. Why do you serve Jesus Christ? Why do you worship him? Why do you live for the Lord? Is your faith a utilitarian faith? That is, are you a Christian simply because of what you can get out of it? May God help us serve him out of a pure heart. understanding that if we get nothing for our labor, we need to know the Lord is still worthy of all that we can give unto him. He knows I come to close here tonight, my brothers and my sisters. I come to the conclusion that if the Lord does not ever do anything else for me, he's already done enough. Can I get a witness? What did he do? He watched over me all night long while I slumbered and slept. He made sure that I had clothes on my back. He made sure that I had food on the table. He's already done enough. Can I get a witness? Yeah.